There he goes. All right. Go ahead and play it through. Good and loud. All right, our first hymn this morning is number 327, and we're doing this because Margie said that back in the day, every day she went to church, they played this one, right, Margie? The Old Rugged Cross, all right? So we're going to sing The Old Rugged Cross. It's number 327. We're just getting warmed up. Everybody say me, me, me. Somebody say you, you, you. All right. There we go. It's number 327, the old rugged cross. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left His glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then He'll call me someday to my home far away, where His glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. There you go, Margie. That's just for you. Happy Valentine's Day. All right, let's bow our hearts and our heads together. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful love. No matter how we say it, we can't form the words. From grateful hearts, realize that the old rugged cross made all the difference in the world. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for our sins. And we ask, Lord, as best the preacher could prepare, as best we can sing, in the best way we know how to pray, you would bless our gathering today. In that marvelous name of our Savior and our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Say hi to somebody. All right. Say happy Valentine's Day. It was an accident I put red on today. Alrighty. Well, if you would please take your outline or your bulletin or whatever we're called. What should we call this? My outline, I guess. But if you'll take that, let's highlight a couple of different things. Last week I had to make some room in the bulletin or the outline, so I didn't include this. But keep praying for Lynn and I as we try to get some leadership from the Lord about going to Israel this year, okay? They're wanting to sell us one-way tickets, but I know you want us to come back. Amen. All right. But anyway, we need some guidance on this, and it really has to do with Lynn being able to get the vaccine shot before we go. But be praying about that for us. Michael Ann forgot that this coming Saturday is February 20th. Now do you remember, Michael Ann? All right. Okay. But you ladies are going to get together for a fellowship at 2 o'clock this Saturday here at the church. So, yeah. Oh, is somebody trying to get my attention? Does Michael Ann ever try to get my attention during church? I don't know. This is a moving experience. Okay. All right. Are we? Another storm on Friday. Does anybody have a snowboard they could loan me? All right. Do you guys think I could use a snowboard? No. I'll borrow. All right. Okay. All right. Now, hopefully by April, the airport would be okay and the landing strips and everything would be clear, because the group is going to try to go to Haiti in April, so be praying about that for them. We're taking up the America for Christ offering right now, and so there should be envelopes in the pews, although many of you took those. I hope that you did what I did. I took mine home. I left it in my wallet. I was praying about it. We put something in the envelope this morning, so there are extra envelopes down in front of the Bible there, so be praying about what you could put in the envelope for the America for Christ offering. I think I said this last Sunday, but the America for Christ offering supports missions in the United States, and it goes to support a number of Baptist centers, which are different than churches. They do a lot of week-a-day ministries, etc. So, all right. That's all the announcements I've got. I'm looking. I understand that the search committee is going to be meeting with Mark Click Saturday. So if somebody has any different news or if something happens, I'm sure that Jacob and all of you all are communicating. Birthdays this coming week. Oh, wait a minute. I feel something over here. I feel some cobwebs over here in this corner. I feel some rickety bones over here. All right, Vicky, stand up. Vicky, stand up. It's Vicky's birthday today. Did I say rickety bones? All right, okay. Happy birthday, Vicky. You look much younger than I'm sure you are. All right? Okay. Anybody else got a birthday this coming week? I'm looking, nobody. Anybody got an anniversary? Did anybody ever get married on Valentine's Day? I guess some people do, but no anniversaries this week. Okay, wait a minute. Joel is talking to Fred, but no. Okay, all right. I thought, he forgot an anniversary. All right, okay. All right, let's see. Well, with that said and done, I really got no further shenanigans to pull off. Let's just take a look at the prayer list real quick, because I didn't add this family, but I want to now. We were singing our trophies, in that song when we were singing, what did we just sing? I'm sorry, the old rugged cross. But Don Key's brother or son, Don Key's son passed away, Kelly. So we did that funeral yesterday. So let's remember the Don Key's family, okay? I've got some others that I've put in here, but I just wanted to mention that, okay? I got your grandma. We got Brian. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, that's when we need to be praying, right? Okay. And what? Oh. Yeah. Okay. All right. Joey? Mm-hmm. Ooh. Wow. Okay. Is she at Children's? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Ooh. Molly. Yeah. All right. Okay. Joey, we'll sure do that. All right. Okay. All right. All. Okay. Boomershine. Okay. And let's pray for Jim. Is Michelle there now? Yeah, Michelle and Brenda are staying around the clock with Faye, with Jim. Seems like he might only have some days left. So keep Jim in your prayers, okay? Connie, go ahead. Amber. Okay. Okay. All right. The Elizabeth Smith, she needs our prayers. That's the Fielder's neighbor. I put Mary Lou Wagner there, and I put Tim's mom. Tim is the pastor up at First Baptist Church, Wilmington, and Tim emailed us and saying that he was at Cleveland Clinic with his mom, and she was septic. I guess everybody knows what that is, but that's why I put them on the prayer list, okay? All right. Yeah, Vicki. Oh, wow. Wow. Last name again. Patton. Okay, sorry. Okay. All right. Well, listen, let's sing another hymn. And when we do that, if you haven't put your offering and tithes in the offering plate, you're welcome to come on forward and put those in there while we sing Trust and Obey, number 571. This has a lot to do with what the preacher wants to say this morning out of Joshua chapter 7. So stand with me, please. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Walk with the Lord in the light of His Word. What a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus
but to trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the skies, but His smile quickly drives it away. Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear, can abide while we trust and... Aren't those beautiful words? Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and... Not a burden we bear, not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. I like that. To be happy in Jesus, but to trust. Let's do the number five one. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says, we will do. Where He sends, we're going to go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Here we go now. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Whew, that's a good message. More to come when the preacher opens his Bible, all right? Well, listen, we were talking about our prayer needs, and Michael Ann, come on up, but let's go to the Lord in prayer now. You can be seated, I'm sorry. Michael Ann, won't you sing for us after we go through our prayer time, okay? And the preacher's going to do something with his hymn book real quick. I keep on referring to myself in the third party. Is that a sign of mental illness that I refer to myself in the third person? Maybe because the preacher is not always present upstairs here every Sunday. Amen? All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, okay? Certainly, we got a lot of needs and a lot of things going on. Thanks for praying for Mom. She's getting along pretty good, and I'm just helping her get through all the paperwork and insurance forms and all that. Pray for the preacher to get some patience with his mother. And because... sometimes she's a little bullheaded, I think. So, well, Lord, we want to thank You for blessing us. Thank You for our different families that surround us, that we're part of. And as Vicki shared, that Quillen and Braxton are on the mends. Then another aunt passes away, and so we want to lift up the Peyton family to You and ask that You'd be a blessing to them. As Mom works through not only her grief but also the various and sundry things that a 93-year-old woman would have to try to figure out, we pray, Lord, that You'd bless us as we kind of help Mom through this time of various things that need to be done. Our heart goes out to Jim right now as he's home and he's having some difficulties, and we don't know that this might not be his last week here on earth. And so we pray that You bless Faye and Brenda and Michelle as they're with their daddy, and folks come and go. We just ask that You'd bless him this week. Others that we continue to keep on our prayer list, Deacon and Lori, we pray for Joanne. We ask, Lord, that You'd be with many of our parents as we are caregivers to them, Georgia and Cleo. We ask, Lord, that You'd be with Bunny as she awaits some results. We pray for Aiden's grandma as he always is concerned about his grandparents, and Brian.
Michael Ann works with. We pray that you'd be with some others that have just come in today. Mary Lou, we pray that you'd bless Tim's mom up at the Cleveland Clinic. We pray that you'd be with the Boomershine family. Elizabeth, as she's battling cancer. Don Keyes, as Kelly has passed and is home with you. We pray that you'd be with Scott and Autumn. We pray that you'd be with Amber as we've had this request. We ask, Lord, that you'd be with Molly as now she has to have emergency surgery. And we pray that you'd bless this little two-year-old as only you can. We pray that you'd wrap your hands around her and keep her safe. And bless those that will have to tend to her physical needs, that a true miracle would take place in her life. Bless Joey and the family as they're concerned and as they take care of her until that time. Lord, with all of these burdens on our hearts, we ask, Lord, that you'd allow us to lay them here at the altar, there at the foot of the cross, knowing that you're no longer on the cross, but you're seated at the right hand of the Father, and you are intercessing for us. We thank you for taking these prayer requests, and the best way we can form words with our mouths, we lift them to you, and yet you look into our hearts. And so thank you for taking care of us and taking those burdens and lifting them, knowing that you are eternal and you're the great physician. So bless in all of these situations. In Jesus' name, amen. Michael Ann was practicing a real pretty song earlier, and so I think it's going to come out real nice for us.
Did you hear about the city on the hill? Said the one old man to the other. It once shined bright and it would be shining still. But they all started turning on each other. Ooh. You see, the poets thought the dancers were shallow, and the soldiers thought the poets were weak. And the elder saw the young ones as foolish, and the rich man never heard the poor man speak. And one by one they ran away with their made-up minds to leave it all behind. As the light began to fade in the city on the hill, the city on the hill. Each one thought that they knew better, but they were different by design. Instead of standing strong together, they let their differences divide. And one by one, they ran away with their minds made up to leave it all behind. And the light began to fade in the city on the hill, the city on the hill. And the world is searching still. It was the rhythm of the dancers that gave the poets life. It was the spirit of the poets that gave the soldiers strength to fight. It was the fire of the young ones. It was the wisdom of the old. It was the story of the poor man that needed to be told. It is the rhythm that gives the poets life. It is the spirit of the poets that give the soldiers strength to fight. It is the fire of the young ones. It is the wisdom of the old. It is the story of the poor man that's needed to be told. One by one we'll be running away with our made-up minds to leave it all behind as the light begins to fade in the city on the hill. One by one we'll be running away with our made-up minds to leave it all behind as the light begins to fade in the city on the hill. The city on the hill. And the Father's calling still, come home to the city on the hill. Come home.
Wow. Good song. All right. Well, in Scripture, I think that you know that the city on the hill, the monitor mic. I think that you guys know that the city on the hill in the Scripture represents what? Do you know? Huh? That's a good guess. It's the church. Jesus said, you are the light of the world. And who lights a candle or a lamp and puts it under a basket? Who does that? And so we're to let our light shine. Michael Ann, you could not have chosen a more appropriate song for the preacher's sermon this morning, so here we go. Find in your Bibles the book of Joshua, and as you find the book of Joshua, I'm going to be kind to your knees, your hips, and your backs. As you stand with me, we're going to read only the first verse of Joshua chapter 7. And actually, I hardly need to read the whole verse. So if you would please, one time I was in Romania and the young man that was translating for me, I said this, the more I read my Bible and preach from it, the fewer verses I actually need to use. And he said, Pastor Steve, did you mean to say that? And so, help me with the understanding of what I'm about to do, but this one verse out of Joshua chapter 7, the first verse sets the whole scene as to what goes on in the rest of the chapter. So therefore, I'm going to read the first verse. Keep your Bibles open thereafter. The children of Israel committed a trespass regarding the accursed things. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed things. So the anger of the Lord burned against the children of Israel. You may be seated. As a proof text, I have a couple with me today. The one is 1 Kings in chapter 18 and verse 21. You'll recall that in 1 Kings chapter 18, Elijah was going to square off with the prophets of Baal. And after that showdown before sundown, God won the battle. After that happened, Elijah said to the people, how long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow Him. But if Baal, follow him. Here's a scary end to that verse. But the people answered him not a word. This morning, as I was going through my sermon and highlighting and underlining, and sometimes if you ever saw my minutes or my notes, my sermons are not minutes, they're hours, right? Amen?
But I mark them up and I highlight them with different colors. But this morning, I was thinking, wait a minute. There's a New Testament passage that speaks to this sermon, and it is from 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 17. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not even obey the gospel of God? What will happen to them if the judgment begins with us, God's people, His church, Michael Ann, the city on the hill? What will happen if it starts with us, everybody else? I would say this to you, and I'll say it boldly and bravely, that if I were ever to, when it comes time for me to leave, I might re-preach this sermon. It would be the last sermon I would want to leave people with as I would be moving on, either here on earth or on into heaven. But the question comes when we start reading this seventh chapter of Joshua. The question is, do I love God enough to obey what He says? Do I love Him enough that I will do as He asked me to do? When Mom was raising us four kids, and she did that on her own, and us kids would come to her and say, Mom, your birthday's coming up. What would you like? And she would say, I want four children who know how to obey me. That's what she wanted for her birthday. You parents, right? Just to have four kids that would do what I asked them to do. Mom, I can't get that, but I'll go to the store and get you something else. Listen, do you and I love Jesus enough to do as He asked us to do? Now here comes a follow-up question, but as Michael Ann sang about the church, this follow-up question is this: do I love Jesus enough to keep my life pure? Do I love Him enough that I would keep my life pure because your purity and mine affects the whole crowd? Michael West left me a note a couple of weeks ago now. He said, Michael's words of wisdom, you can take that to the bank. It'll be a withdrawal, not a deposit. But, he wrote this, because of little expenses, a small leak will sink a great ship. I'm here to tell you that I believe that the church in the world today is in trouble. I think of 2 Samuel chapter 6, when Uzziah and the Israelites were moving the ark back from when the Philistines had it. Tim and I were looking at that when the Philistines first took it. You find the word Ebenezer there. But Uzzah was part of the group that was moving, transporting the Ark of the Covenant from the territory of the Philistines back to Israel. And when it started rocking and rolling, so to speak, Uzzah put his hand up. And what did he do? He touched the Ark of the Covenant. What happened? Now. Because he wasn't permitted to touch it. We see in the story in Genesis, and we've gone through this, that Sodom and Gomorrah was burnt to the ground because of their sin. But there was one who was escaping. And as she was following her husband and their two girls, she looked back. A simple look. But what had God told them? Don't turn back. And she turned into a pillar of salt. In the New Testament, we find that as the disciples were gathering thousands of people who were trusting Christ, and many of them had no more income, they had no more place to stay, they had nothing to eat, and people were bringing offerings and leaving it at the disciples' feet, and they were feeding thousands of people. And yet there's a couple who want to cheat the Holy Spirit. Their names are Ananias and Sapphira.
They brought a gift, but they lied about it. And what happened to them? Now. They died now. It's important for you and I to realize that when God says something, boys and girls, He means it. As I'm reading through my Bible, I ran across this one, 2 Kings chapter 17. They feared the Lord, yet served their own gods. Tell me, does that work? It does not work. It won't work. And so when we take a look at Joshua chapter 7, not only are we preaching through the Old Testament about the miracles, but today I'd like to talk to you about when the miracles stop. As they have been dealing with the coronavirus and they have been dealing with what causes it, they've also discovered what will not cause it, right? And that's how they've come up with the vaccine, and some of you are getting that vaccine. When we take a look at Joshua chapter 7, the miracles are happening, but now they stop. What is it that you and I can do that allow for the flow of the miracles? With your Bibles open, we have to look at what sin was committed and by whom. The first thing on my outline, the sin of Achan. It was the taking of the accursed things. I will say this, that this method, four-step outline, what took place with Achan is exactly what took place with Eve in the garden. First, she saw the fruit. Secondly, she coveted the fruit. She desired it. Thirdly, she took of it, and she and Adam ate it. And after they ate it, they hid. Wow. Is that it? Is that what the old devil promises you and I? That after we participate in a sin, all we do is hide ourselves? Big reward, right? As you read through your Bible, and I believe that you're going to see the confession of Achan in verse 21. There it is. Go ahead and turn there. Joshua 7, verse 21. This is what he says to Joshua. When I saw among the spoils a beautiful Babylonian garment and 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and I took them, and there they are, hidden in the earth in the midst of my tent. Big deal. You and I have to be guarding our eyes. What is that little song? Be careful, little eyes, what you see. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. All right? Well, listen, our eyes need to be guarded. You remember what Job said? I've made a covenant with my eyes. Would unto God that we would all start there. Turn away from it. Look away from it. Don't let your eyes lock onto it for very long, because soon your heart can follow. The 10th commandment. Thou shalt not covet, desire, long for what everybody else has or what anybody else has. I will say this in the process of Joshua chapter 7. Achan had many opportunities to repent, and he did not do it. And thus, the tone of chapter 7 is set for you and I. I want to say this, that as Joshua is a great leader, he still cannot do this for Achan. As much as Joshua has heard the voice of the Lord, he's a great leader, he's a spiritual servant, he could not fix this. If you and I disconnect from our Lord, we start sinking in the Sea of Galilee just like Peter did, who took his eyes off the Lord and got worried about the storm instead. Billy Graham was a great preacher, and yet
We still have social ills in this country and around the globe, don't we? He's a great preacher. He couldn't fix everything. It's up to you and I. There is only one delinquent in this group. And yet God says, Israel has sinned. And my point, boys and girls, listen to me carefully. When one person disobeys the Lord, the rest of the congregation can suffer. One of Joshua's pleas, and we'll get there soon enough, was very powerful, and you and I need to remember that. We need to fix our mind on how Joshua pled out to the Lord. But let's travel on. You and I know that if we go back just a chapter or two, that Joshua was instructed by God that Israel participate in two ordinances. That they were to circumcise the men, and then they were all to have the Passover meal together. May I say this to you boldly and bravely? That did not fix the heart problem that Achan experienced. It wasn't enough. Listen to me loud and clear. I say this pretty often. But when a person wants to be baptized, it's not that the baptismal water will wash away their sins. If that would be the case, you and I need to leave here with buckets of water and go douse the rest of the world as we go past them, right? If water would fix it, let's go do it. It's not. You see, baptism doesn't put Jesus in your heart. It's a testimony that you've already got Jesus in your heart. Any amens out there from the Baptist among us? When we have communion, the little piece of bread and the sip of juice that we take does not put Jesus in your heart. It's a testimony that He is there because we believe in His sacrifice for our sins. Amen, everybody? What Israel had to do before they after they crossed the Jordan River, they were now in the Promised Land, they're ever so ready now to go on and conquer the land. It wasn't enough to fix the internal problem that Achan had. Joshua sends spies. They come back and they say, hey, listen, this little town of Ai, we don't need to worry too much about it. Let's only send about 3,000 soldiers. By the way, don't underestimate our enemy. Because our enemy is not flesh and blood, is it? It's spiritual. God humbled Israel with this defeat. He hardened the Canaanites with their victory. And God here evidences His displeasure with sin. Joshua is a mighty good leader, my second point here. Because in the final analysis, when it is figured out who had committed this sin, Joshua calls Achan son. Come here, son. Give God the glory, he says. He doesn't cast failure, grief over the failure onto his army or onto the spies. He grieves over the failure. He prays and he pleads with God and he waits for the answer. And the plea he makes is for God's name. Look at verse 9. Now, it is our name and your great name that is at stake, verse 9 gives us. You remember when Jesus prayed, he prayed that God's name would be glorified, even in his death on the cross. You and I have a lot riding on this, boys and girls. When people call us Christians, that means something. And by the way, in the public domain, it's going to be more rare that people want to be called Christians, but that doesn't dilute the fact that you and I are, and we need to live up to it. We need to live up to that name of Christ. It was first given to us in Antioch when they made fun of us. Oh, there goes those little Jesuses, those little Christs. It was because people act like Jesus that we got that name. Let's not dilute the name Christian, and let's not take away from Christ's name. My third point. After spending the whole day in prayer at the time of the evening sacrifice, God comes along and says, I want to speak to you about this for a minute. It's not about the soldiers. It's not their problem. It's not about your strength. No, there's millions of you. It's not about the statistics. There's more of you than there were in Ai. By the way, if they'd have sent 30,000, 10 times the soldiers, I think it would still come out the same. But God, His answer was a very simple word, sin. When will you and I get it right? Seriously, when will you and I get it right? Joshua had spent his time in prayer, and so God comes along and says, enough, Joshua, I've heard enough. Ooh, really? Ecclesiastes says, everything is beautiful in its own time. And God says, I've heard you, Joshua, but now it's time to get up because I want to tell you what's wrong. God instructs Joshua. Remember, he speaks and we are to listen. God expected Joshua to follow his commandment, and he extended mercy in the whole process to Achan. I'll say something about the death penalty because that's what happened. My fourth point. In Achan, there was no remorse. There was no repentance. Look at verse 15. Throughout this process, he makes the statement, I have sinned. But may I say this to you? And by the way, I might work up a sermon next Sunday, the Lord willing, and the... There are seven people in our Bible that said this very same thing. I have sinned. If I get a message from the Lord, I'll try to bring that to you next Sunday. Achan said, I have sinned, but may I tell you something? It's pretty shallow. I got a feeling that those words were about only an inch deep. What he was sorry about was that he got caught. Is anybody out there among that tribe that has been sorry because we've gotten caught? We never felt the sorrow. We didn't want to say, I sinned when we did it, but oh, once it was found out, oh, I'm sorry. I wonder how many judges sits on benches in this country and hears some shallow little phrase. I'm sorry, judge, I did wrong. Well, you got caught, that's why. Achan got caught. There's mercy to be had, and there's true repentance that must take place. But if there's not true repentance and no change of heart, God comes down hard and heavy, doesn't He? You see, sin in the Christian's life separates us from the fellowship that we need to have with Christ. As a non-Christian, if we don't repent of our sins, then there's a separation for all of eternity. My fifth point in the outline is simply that, redemption and repentance. You see, the first is an act of God. That's grace. If you don't know what the word redemption means, go to a pawn shop. You'll learn a little bit about redemption then. No, let me take you further. Let me take you to some of the countries that still have slave markets. And there he is, a young man on a pedestal, and the bids are going out. They're auctioning off a slave, and the father comes and says, whatever the bid is, I'll double it. Give me my son back. That's redemption. Look up here. Jesus Christ, the very Son of God, looked down on us. And the old devil had his grasp around your neck. And he was shaking you like a stuffed baby doll. And Jesus said, get your hands off of him. I died for that sin. That's redemption, boys and girls. Ooh, I'm getting chill bumps. I might get ready to preach here in a minute. The grace of Jesus, that is free, boys and girls. And when that happens, our part is to repent from the sin, to turn away from it. We don't want to do that anymore. The chains fall off. And by being a saved person, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit. I got to remembering a story. Years ago, I was able to go to Romania, and every time I went, I tried to take medications. The poor country, aspirins were like miracle drugs to them. I'm serious. I went to a little village. The name of the village was called, Gresheria, okay? And there was a little boy, and somebody said, Pastor Steve, do you have any medicine for his toe? Now, as little a thing as you thought that might have been, that little boy sat down in front of me, and I got on my knees. I squeezed it, and about a half cup of pus came out of it. I said, this toe ain't going to last long. This foot's not going to last long. Barefoot, dirty. I got some peroxide and doused it, dried it off. Then I got some Neosporin. Just simple Neosporin. And I packed that into that wound. Oh, wait a minute. Then I sealed it with a bandage. Ah, the missing ingredient. Before I left that village a week later, that little boy said, Pastor Steve, look at my toe now. And we opened it up and it was like it was brand new. Well, listen, boys and girls, this is what happens. Jesus died, and he comes to you and me, and he says, let me squeeze you. And all the old pus comes out. Oh, wait a minute, I got something to cure that. Let me put the Holy Spirit in you. Now, wait a minute, let me seal you with the Holy Spirit so that old infection never comes back. Why is the world going to hell in a handbasket? It's because they haven't been sealed. That's why. What was the greatness of Achan's sin? There were two things I want to say about this sin. Both of them were in the face of God. A long time ago, I realized I was going to be at the face of God someday. When I was 16, I thought it was going to happen within that year. God surprised me. That's been over 50 years ago. But I realized that if I were to die, I would meet my master, my maker, face to face. And I would not want to stand there on my terms. I wanted to stand there on his terms. God pronounced the standard when they went to Ai. He had already said it back at Jericho. Do not take these things. And yet Achan did. When they got to Ai, it was a miserable failure. So what was the nature of Achan's sin? Here it comes. Achan took what God called rubbish. The rubbish was anything that would be burned in the fire. And what Achan saw was a beautiful Babylonian garment. Wait a minute. You guys are Jews. You're not Babylonian. You're not supposed to look like that, dress like that, smell like that, act like that. That's accursed. Some Bible commentators say this about this garment. It was like a prince's robe. Achan took it. No one else in Israel had one. Look at me. Can you keep up with the Joneses now? God said this is rubbish. It's to be burnt. But Achan took it because he could one up on everybody else. That's not what God wants his people to do. Amen? We're not to look like the world. We're God's people, not the world's people. The second thing about Achan's sin was this. He took what God called his own. What was to be his own was everything that was metal that could pass through the fire. Iron, bronze, silver, and gold. But Achan saw some silver and it shined pretty good. He found the gold and he thought, oh boy, ain't nobody in my neighborhood got this. But God said, this is mine. That was the sin nature of what Achan did. I want to say this one more time. But you and I are called to God's will, to do it God's way, using God's watch, His timing. If we get one of those factors out of sync, then we're doomed. As Christians, we're to do God's will, God's way, in God's timing. My seventh point, and I'm wrapping it down, comes from Numbers chapter 32. Make sure your sin will find you out. Let's say it again. Be sure your sin will find you out. There's some songs out there, and some of the lyrics go, Lord, show me the way. There was surgery needed here. The sin had to be cut out. Now, mind you, if you go through the rest of the chapter, you'll find that starting in verse 16, after God told Joshua what the deal was, what had happened, God told him without using a name. Ooh. Did God not know Achan's name? Answer, he knew. He didn't want Joshua to know yet. You see, that was going to filter everything that Joshua would do from that point on. He would already know who the guilty party was. Joshua did not know. He knew that there was guilt. He knew that there was sin, but he didn't know the individual. And so God said, line up all of Israel, millions of people. Look for the right tribe. It was Judah. Then look for the right clan, and it was so-and-so. And then look for the right family. Then look for the right father. There he is, Achan. Now let me help you understand something. Because when Joshua and Israel worked through that process, at every stage, Achan could have said, Joshua, I'm stepping forward. I'm the guy. And the results probably were going to be different. But no. Through this process, Achan held his own, thinking that the sin would not be exposed. Boys and girls, may I say something to you? You cannot hide from God. You cannot hide your sin. And the best thing you can do is stand before a loving and forgiving Father and say, in Jesus, I'm washed in the blood, but one of your children stepped out of bounds. You need to be able to say that to Him. Achan could not do that. And therefore, the death penalty was invoked. There was no remorse. There was no repentance. I'm sorry that I got caught. That's basically what Achan said. What happened then with the capital punishment? Well, there's six things that I want to say briefly. Ready? Here they come. There was a place. He was taken outside the camp. Remember, when Jesus died on the cross, it was not actually in Jerusalem. It was out on Golgotha. It was outside the camp, so to speak. And so Achan was taken out of the camp. There were persons. And all of Israel was to participate in this. I'm sorry to tell you this, but it was a public example. How many of the Jews do you think disobeyed a direct command of God from that point on? Ooh. Did that make everybody hup to? You're not a kidding. all of Israel participated in this. I want you to picture not only Jesus being taken outside of Jerusalem, but I want you to picture Him on the cross as a public example of death for sin. God was saying, this is what your disobedience has cost me. My only begotten Son. The next time you want to toy with sin, the next time you linger too long, the next time you look an extended period of time and all of a sudden you feel something in your heart saying, wow, that looks pretty good. I want you to turn your eyes to Jesus. Turn your eyes to Jesus and picture what that lusting, that coveting cost our Heavenly Father. His only Son. Not one of us in this room would offer up our child as a sacrifice for sin. Not one of us would. I know you all. All of Israel. Who were the partakers in this? The stolen goods. All of the goods that Achan had stolen was set afire. All of it was destroyed. But also all of Achan's goods, period. His whole family was stoned. And you think, why? You look at verse 21, you realize that when Achan had stolen this, he took it to his tent and buried it in the middle of his tent. Who was in his tent? His whole family. Any one of them could have gone to Joshua and say, Joshua, we got a problem. It's Dad. It's Dad. And they would have been cleared. They aided and they abetted. They consented to this sin. And because of that, they all were put to death. The punishment was being stoned to death. They were burnt in a pile and then a pile of rocks placed on top of them. Wait a minute, go back one or two chapters and you realize that over there at the Jordan, there was a memorial. Out in the middle of the Jordan, there was another memorial. God let them pass through on dry ground. They were to look at that memorial and say, praise God! Now they come over here outside the skirts of Jericho, outside the city limits of Ai. And what is it? There's a pile of stones there. Ooh, that's not such a nice, pleasant thing. It represented sin. Don't you wish you could take your sin and throw it in a pile and set it aflame and throw rocks on it and never see it again? Oh, wait a minute. Hello. Hello. That's what Jesus did. My Bible says He takes our sins and removes them as far as the east is from the west. They're gone. Don't look back on them. Don't desire them. Don't remember them. Don't do it again. That's repentance. God's wrath was pacified. God was appeased. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. The last thing I want to say is this place was renamed. I believe it's the last, there it is, the last verse of chapter 7. The place was called the Valley of Achor. By the way, if you do your homework, that's another way of saying Achan. And the name Achan means trouble. Trouble. All my trouble is gone. It's under that pile of rocks. Don't trouble Jesus. Don't trouble His people. I got to remembering something, and Tim, just like in you and I, were trying to use Google this morning. Early this morning, I had to use Google because I was trying to remember a simple little prayer by a simple little man in the Old Testament. Here it comes. Many of you have read the book. The Prayer of Jabez. Have you ever read that little booklet? It's really an easy read. It's a fun little book. The Prayer of Jabez. Are you ready for this? When Jabez prays, His last phrase of that prayer is simply this, that I may not cause pain. Woo! If the church in the world today is in trouble, don't let it be because of you. Because we're all in this together. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Make sure your sins are forgiven. Make sure they're paid for by Jesus' blood. That when you stand before a holy God, He can't look at your sin because it's under a pile of rocks. It's under the blood. When we stand there, there's no judgment. There's forgiveness. And our advocate, Jesus Christ, says, Father, He's one of ours. He's one of ours. I want you to bow your hearts and your heads with me. The last thing you'd want to do today is leave without knowing Jesus Christ is in your heart. Myself and others are all around you. If you need to make sure Jesus is there in your heart, before you leave, let's make sure you do that. If there's something on your heart that you need to leave at the foot of the cross, if you need the front steps as an altar, you want to come on the front pew, you want the pastor to pray with you, I'm happy to do that. In a moment, we're going to sing, I Surrender All. I'm going to finish the way I started. Do I love my Lord enough to obey Him? Do I love His church enough to be pure? So, sweet Jesus, hear our plea. I have sinned. Thank You for Your forgiveness. Now, find us each and every one surrendered to Your Lordship. In Jesus' name. It's number 596, I Surrender All. We're just going to do the first and last verses, but if there's something you need to step out and do in obedience to Him, please do it. I Surrender All, number 596, the first and last verses.
Jesus, I surrender all to Him. I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily.
Now make this your prayer. Ready?
I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
On the fourth one.
All to Jesus I surrender. Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power. Let Thy blessings fall.
Here it comes.
Surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
What did Jesus say in the Garden of Gethsemane? Not my will, but Thine be done. Lord, bless us as we leave here, and may we make that our prayer. Not my will, Lord, but Yours be done. Bless this church as we seek to obey You this week. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. Good seeing everybody. In the round table. On the round table.